I have a ton of tech waste and no idea what to do with it. I know I can't throw it in the trash, that's illegal. I know there are special recycling centers I could take it to, but some of this stuff still seems valuable to someone. So then I've held on to this for years, thinking maybe I'll donate it or sell it, and then I end up not doing anything with it because it seems like too much work to figure out the best use for it all. I'm not alone here. In 2022, 62 million tons of e-waste was created, and less than a quarter of that was recycled. So clearly you guys don't know what to do with your stuff either. But we need to figure it out because the e-waste problem is only growing. We have limited repair options, products already have shorter life cycles because of planned obsolescence, and as we infuse tech into everything, we just end up with more tech waste. In fact, the amount of e-waste being created is growing 5 times faster than it's being recycled. So today, I'm gonna see what the best options are for getting rid of all this stuff. First, I'm gonna take my junk around to figure out what could still be useful to someone and what's ready to be stripped for parts and recycled. But what does it actually look like to recycle tech waste? And are recycling companies gonna be able to keep up with this growing problem? And is there any way that we can slow this problem down? I'm about to head out. I found a few places to go. Here's what I'm bringing. 4 iPhones of varying years. 1 TI-83 calculator that got me through 4 rounds of the ACT that I did terrible on. 1 vape that I do not use. I do not vape. I got this as a prop for a video. 2 MacBook charging cords, and 1 MacBook Air with assorted stickers. And now I'll head out and see what I can get for all this fantastic stuff. I'm gonna start off seeing what I could sell. I have a couple places I'm going to. I did pick the absolute coldest day to do this. I'm on my way to like a tech pawn shop place called Paymore. All right, I learned a lot in there. It would only take my 2 newer iPhones, the laptop and the calculator. The laptop, it would give me $25, the calculator $5, and the 2 iPhones, they would give me $80 each for if they were unlocked and the iCloud was disconnected. I also asked how they set their prices, and he said it's all just based on how things are priced on eBay. Also, my laptop was almost at the cutoff where they wouldn't take it. They won't take any laptops older than 2015, and they won't take any iPhones or iPads that still have the home button. They did offer to recycle my stuff that they wouldn't take, and he suggested that I go to Apple and check out the Apple credit for all of those products. I decided to bike to the Apple store. It's so far. Why is there no close Apple store? What's up with that? It's like too old to, okay.
For a value case.
All right, Apple was super convenient. Will give me way more for the 2 new phones, but they are actually saying that my laptop is so old it needs to be recycled and they won't give me a value for it. And with Apple, that's an Apple credit. It's not cash. All right, now it's time to check out a couple of recycling centers. I went to a New York State government website and I found this like huge list of places to take things, but it wasn't really clear. So I kept looking and I found this from 311, which was much clearer, which says that Best Buy and Goodwill are drop-off centers that should take all my stuff. Hi, I read online that I could donate tech waste stuff here. Is that true? Okay, I'm kind of surprised, but Goodwill was a total bust. She seemed to have no idea what I was talking about, and then she confirmed with her manager, and she was like, we do not accept any electronics here. Next stop for recycling is Best Buy. I feel like I have higher hopes because I think I've heard of people recycling stuff there before. But we'll see. I would have thought Goodwill worked too. Also, coldness update. My hands are frozen through my gloves. But we're powering through in the name of content and in the name of tech waste recycling. It's so cool, my eyes are watering. Hi, I read online that you guys accept tech waste recycling. Do you guys do that here? Are you guys loving this sly, film myself in public angle? All right, well, in terms of convenience, Best Buy is winning by a mile. They literally just had a big bin that said electronics recycling. She said you don't actually have to wait in the line like I did. You just put it all in there. If it's a TV or a monitor, they charge a $30 fee for it, but everything else they'll just take and recycle for you, no questions asked. All right, now we figured out recycling and selling. I'm on my way back to the office and we're gonna figure out donating. None of the donate places will let you go in person. They're all online. It's not as fun, but we're gonna go figure out my options for donating at the office.
Thank you for calling Giving Center.
Hi, I have a MacBook Air from 2015. So for this place, I can donate my old laptop that'll be used by someone in need who applied for it. And it also says that I will get a current market value tax deduction. So that's pretty good. This other place seems largely the same. I fill out a form online, and then they'll email me to schedule a date and time for my drop-off. This place says they also accept desktops, tablets, monitors, keyboards and mice, and computer accessories. So some of that stuff will go on to be used for a few more years, but then it'll also need to be recycled. But what does that process actually look like? And why can't these recycling companies keep up with the amount of waste we're creating? I found one of the largest e-waste recycling facilities in the US to get an inside look.
Morning. It's like 6 a.m. and we are on our way to Complete Recycling Services just outside Boston. This place processes any and all tech waste and it's currently processing 10 million pounds of it a year. Today we're getting a tour from the owner, Keith, who's gonna show us how it all works.
So this is like half of the building?
So the total volume that we receive is around 5.5 million pounds at this facility. TerraCycle just made another acquisition of a company up in New Hampshire that adds another 8 million pounds to that total. So we're probably in the 12 to 15 million pound category annually for e-waste.
About 70% of this is coming from businesses, 20% from consumers, and 10% from government organizations.
So many of the materials that we take in are driven by regulation. The company that we just acquired up in New Hampshire actually has a segment in Maine where they run about 80% of the EPR program, taking back electronic waste.
EPR, Extended Producer Responsibility, is a law that makes companies who produce tech also hit a certain quota of recycling tech waste. It's been a huge success in helping to increase recycling rates, but not all states have adopted it yet. Most of what CRS does is called demanufacturing. It's actually just the first step in the chain of recycling, and then they send all those broken down parts to different downstream recyclers, but I'll get into more of that later.
For all the electronics that come in, there's really a downstream for everything, with a small exception of maybe some old console TVs from the 60s and 70s. That were made with a press board, glue board. That external glue board, we don't have a great recycle option for that.
That's like an incredible amount of stuff that you do have a recycling process for them. That's crazy.
They work on one type of tech waste at a time, so it's easier to get into a rhythm, and also because different products have different types of materials they're pulling off to be sorted. On the day we went, they were all processing TVs.
So when TVs come into this facility, they have to be manually taken apart and sorted. There are a few main components with TVs. These old TVs have cathode ray tubes. They have leaded glass on one side and clean glass on the other. These go to a company in New Hampshire that pulverizes it and separates the glass. The plastic gets baled here and then shipped to a downstream partner that pelletizes it and introduces it back into the market, sometimes even for new TVs. This is what it looks like after the plastic is baled.
Let's pause here for a second. When I was researching this story, a lot of news was coming out about recycled plastic from tech waste ending up in consumer food products like spatulas and to-go containers, which, like, yikes. So I asked Keith about it.
And you said sometimes that plastic goes back to Samsung, for example, a TV manufacturer.
Correct.
Does any of that end up in consumer goods?
It's very possible. It would be limited and restricted from like food grade containers.
I followed up for more info on that and learned that because of their R2 certification from the EPA, CRS and any of its downstream recyclers cannot send their plastic to be used in food products. But not all companies are R2 certified, which is how that plastic ends up in food products anyway. It's a major part of the e-waste recycling system that needs to be fixed to make sure this recycled plastic is used safely by all companies. But back to the recycling process.
Another thing they're pulling off the TVs is these copper yolks, which are worth about 45 cents a pound, and this, for example, is about a pound and a half. Then those copper yolks and these low-grade boards are sent to a downstream in New Jersey. They'll be smelted for metal recovery.
This copper is one of the most valuable things that CRS recovers from the tech, and it's also one of the most important. We're in a global copper shortage, so we really shouldn't be throwing any of it in the trash.
There's also tons of copper wire coming off these TVs. They're given to Mid-City Steel, who strips it and separates the copper from the plastic. There's also this degaussing wire that's copper and aluminum that's also sent to the downstream in New Jersey.
Another large part of their organization processes batteries, which have to be handled very carefully.
So some of the batteries that they get in are really reactive because they're lithium. So what they do is they literally tape over them, which prevents them from starting a fire.
A lot of batteries look basically identical, so it can be a really time-consuming process, so they need a skilled worker to sort them safely and quickly.
It's very confusing because a lot of the alkalines will look identical to the lithiums, so our sorting person is pretty well versed with determining which type is which. I believe this
what
is probably
a lithium. What would happen if they got mixed up?
Well, again, you would just run the risk of a fire if you had lithiums mixed in with alkalines.
Where does the Laffy Taffy go?
It goes with the watch. Metal's very conducive, and if the positive and negative touch, it'll short circuit. The tape eliminates that.
Where do these batteries go from here?
These batteries go to one of our R2 certified downstreams down in Georgia, where it'll literally grind up all the batteries and it'll separate off any of the metals and any of the hazardous components where they reclaim.
So what I'm learning a lot of today is that it's very hard to process anything fully in one facility. It sounds like a lot of, you guys break it down and do what you can and then pass along the smaller parts to the other people that specialize in those.
That's pretty accurate, and that's very typical with most e-waste recyclers.
Here are the downstreams where all of the commodities from CRS go. They're a mix of independent companies and other companies that are owned by the same parent company. Some tech waste is more valuable than others based on how hard it is to process, and what it's made of. For example, older GPUs have a lot more gold and silver than new ones. So some of the products cost CRS to send to the downstreams, like cathode ray tube TVs and batteries, because they have hazardous materials that are expensive to process. But some of the commodities CRS gets paid for, like the circuit boards, wire, and plastic, because they're easier to process and the end commodity is easy to sell. The only thing CRS processes all the way through is mercury, which is found in a lot of the lights for TVs and laptops. Handling mercury here requires special certifications, approval from the city, tons of equipment, and employee protections. But CRS goes through all of this because it gets them more business.
Many states have regulated electrical components and mercury-containing devices into a category called universal waste, where it really drives recycling.
So this giant machine here takes the mercury out of glass that might be in the back of a display on your computer or your TV, and now this is just glass with no mercury. But what happens to the mercury? So the remaining mercury is processed here and recovered. This is basically a giant oven. The oven gets up to about 700 degrees Celsius for 10 hours, and the mercury is vaporized. So this stuff in here has already been cooked, it's just cooling down, and the mercury goes over here. So the mercury vapor travels through this tube, where it's filtered through carbon, and then cooled into its liquid form, where it's collected in this drum, which is full of liquid mercury. They fill it once every 3 to 4 months, and then they can sell it back to the market as pure mercury.
Processing mercury not only lets them accept more types of e-waste, but it also makes them great money on the back end. But if some e-waste is expensive to process, why not just turn it away and only accept the stuff that makes money?
We typically want to be a one-stop shop. We still accept components where it costs us more to process by charging a little bit more on the front end, and it's an added value to the customer. So if they're shipping us cathode ray tubes, they may also be sending fluorescent light bulbs and batteries and other tech components that contain more value.
CRS has a really strong business model because they charge people on the front end to collect their waste, which they're willing to pay for because it's so convenient. Then any value from the commodities recovered on the back end is just a bonus instead of trying to rely on that as their main form of income. Another reason their business is so strong is that regulation is working in their favor.
So many of the items that we bring in are legally bound to be recycled due to some rules called universal waste rules. So for example, all the fluorescent lighting, all the batteries, many states actually put electronics into universal waste as well. They need to be recycled rather than disposed of.
CRS's size and the fact that they have a much larger parent company also helps them stay competitive because they can afford more advanced certifications from the EPA.
A lot of the certifications have thinned out some of the smaller mom and pop competitors. In order to be a player in this industry, you really need to be R2 certified or E-Stewards, which is a significant expense. Many of the requests for pricing and bids and proposals that we receive mandate that the processor be R2 certified.
To get the R2 certification from the EPA, not only does your factory have to meet those requirements, but all of your downstream processors have to meet the same standards. As a product of the Juul in the middle school bathroom generation, I've seen just how fast those nicotine addicts burn through those neon adult pacifiers. Americans are throwing out 4.5 vapes a second. So why aren't there any vapes here?
So as a company, we're very interested in receiving vapes and e-cigarettes. There is a gray area, however, in the regulations, where if the vapes or e-cigarettes contain liquid, it puts them into a hazardous waste category currently in most states, so we're not able to receive them.
Tech waste is a problem that's gonna get worse before it gets better. We're burning through tech waste faster than ever, and current recycling efforts just can't keep up. There are some positive things, though. There are growing movements to push back against planned obsolescence and increase right to repair laws. And a growing portion of Gen Z is choosing used phones over new phones, decreasing their consumption. Government regulation has helped a lot with things like extended producer responsibility laws. But they could help a lot more if they would adapt to new types of tech waste faster, like vapes, to make it easier for recyclers to process those. But as we saw, tech waste recycling takes a lot of difficult, expensive labor, so even with clearer regulation, this process is still messy. For now, as a consumer, the most important thing to do is make sure you're properly getting rid of all your tech waste. You can donate or sell whatever still has useful life and take the rest to a recycling center. But before you get rid of your old laptop, use it to check out Nebula. If you don't know by now, Nebula is the hottest new streaming service where you can watch videos without any ads from tons of great creators, including me. And if you sign up with this link, not only do I get a cut of it, thanks, but also you can get 40% off. That's what we in business call a win-win. On Nebula, you can stream all my Morning Brew videos with no ads. So if you liked learning about why it's so hard to get rid of your tech waste, you can also watch me figure out how marathons make money, what it's like to run a hot dog cart, and how the food delivery industry works. You can watch all your favorite Morning Morning Brew franchises ad-free, like Morning Brew Daily and Good Work. And speaking of Good Work, host Dan Toomey was recently in an original show on Nebula called The Getaway. It's a competition series following six creators on a road trip as they compete against each other and try to find out who the snitch is that's sabotaging them. But the twist is, they're all the snitch. So give your old laptop a beautiful send-off by using it to sign up for Nebula at this link for 40% off, and then recycling it. The circle of life.
I've never seen one of these signs in real life. It's not just a meme.
TVs are so weird. Who knew?
There may be
it's
some,
so scary when there, you put your hand
there
in
may
it.
Be some small.
Better you than me.
Should I have a hazmat suit?